Random House Audio presents No Man's Man, a dramatization of the short story by Louis L'Amour.
The afternoon was fading slowly when the tall, thin gentleman rode up to the dirty cantina. The sun was beginning to sink towards the hills over beyond San Carlos. The low adobe walls of the building cast long shadows in the courtyard as the man reined his horse in beside the hitching rail and slid down.
Oh!
I watched as he hitched his horse in front of the stable, then shook a peck of red Mexican dust off his coat before crossing the yard towards the cantina. He stood for a moment in the low doorway, taking in the scene with a curious eye. A few vaqueros stood at the bar.
Buenos dias, señor. Welcome, welcome.
The bartender grinned. His black mustache curled back, revealing an impressive row of large white teeth.
Come in, come in.
The tall man nodded and didn't move. Instead, he continued his inspection of the place. Another group of men sat around a table on the far side of the room, an open bottle on the table in front of them. One of them was holding a guitar. The man's eyes swept on and didn't stop as they passed the corner where I was seated, deep in the shadows, my back to the wall and a gun on the table, and my left hand pouring tequila into a glass. I had chosen the table and the cantina for this very moment. The man smiled at the bartender and stepped into the room. He turned to face me as he spoke.
Another bottle of tequila for the table in the corner.
Si, señor. I'm coming right up.
Slowly, deliberately, he crossed the room to my table. A man with a scholar's face and a quiet eye, but with lines of slender strength. He never so much as glanced at the gun on the table.
Well, I told them I wanted a man big enough and strong enough to tackle a grizzly, and they sent me to you. I guess they figured I meant it.
Your tequila, señores. The lemons and salt.
Thank you.
De nada, señor.
How much? And where's the grizzly?
His name is Henry Wetterling, and he's the boss of the biggest outfit in a place called Battle Basin, about 2 days' ride north of the border. I'll give you $1,000.
The scholar, as I came to call him, looked me straight in the eye as he named this figure. It was not enough. I wondered if he knew it. Perhaps he wanted to see how I would react. What do I do?
There's a girl up there, name of Nana Maduro. She owns a ranch.
At the mention of Nana Maduro, my face froze. Smaller than I wondered if the scholar noticed.
I believe his is the biggest ranch in Battle Basin, but Nana Maduro's land's the best in the whole countryside, and Wetterling wants it. He's tried courting her, but so far...
I had never been to Battle Basin, although I'd heard of it. There isn't a ruse he won't. I knew Nana Maduro, though. A finer-looking woman had never drawn breath on God's earth as far as I was concerned. I had known her for almost as long as I could remember. I had loved her, too. But events had come between us.
Wetterling wants the girl, and he wants her ranch. I don't want him to have either.
You want him dead.
I want him out of there. Use your own judgment. When I hire a man for a job, I don't tell him how to do it.
This man with the scholar's face was more than a quiet man. He could also be a hard man. I thought again about the fee he had mentioned. The idea of seeing Nana again had aroused my interest. At that point, I would probably have taken the job for nothing. But I knew that that was no way to begin to drive a bargain.
One more thing. Wetterling is top dog up in those parts, and nobody gets in his way.
Huh?
But he has two men to back him up. The names are Clevenger and Mac.
All right, but the price is higher. I want $5,000.
I like a man who puts a proper estimate on the job. 5, 6, 7, 8.
He reached in his pocket and drew out a wallet and began counting out green bills on the dirty tabletop.
3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. $2,000. The rest when you're finished.
I couldn't argue with that. He pushed back his chair and got up. I looked at the pile of $100 bills and thought of the long months of punching cows I'd have to put in to earn that much money.
Where do you fit in? You want the girl, or the ranch, or Wetterling's hide?
You're paid to do a job, Morgan, not for asking questions.
The ride up to Cherry Creek was pleasant, with sunlight on the trail and cloud shadows on the hills for much of the way. But by the afternoon of the second day, when I rode into the town of Battle Basin, it had grown hot and still like cyclone weather. The town folks stared at me as I rode my big red horse down the dusty street, and well, they might. My mother was Spanish, and I was told that I had her dark good looks. But from my father, I had inherited the strength and the build of Welsh coal mining stock. I was 3 inches over 6 feet, with black hair curling around my ears under a black, flat-brimmed, flat-crowned hat. The shirt I wore was a sweat-soaked, dirty red beneath a black horsehide vest, and there was a scar on my left cheek where a knife blade had bit to the bone.
Who?
When I swung down in front of the local saloon, folks gathered round to look at my horse. Blood bay with black mane, tail, and forelock. A heavy-set gent in a white apron leaned on his broom and stared.
Will you look at that?
Say, mister, that's a lot of horse.
16 hands at the shoulder, I'll bet.
Not a bad guess. 17, actually. What's your name, sonny?
Billy Travers.
Well, Big Red here is 1,300 pounds of the finest horse flesh in Texas. I want you to keep an eye on him, okay?
You betcha, mister.
With a smile to the boy, I stepped onto the boardwalk. The man in the white apron followed me into the saloon. Give me a tequila.
I'm coming right up, mister.
He brought out a bottle and opened it. Then he found a lemon and salt. So I had a drink there, and another. I looked around the room and it all looked familiar, although it had been quite a while since I'd set foot this far north of the border.
Have another, mister?
Thanks. I'm looking for a ranch on Cherry Creek. It's owned by Nana Maduro.
Well, then you'd be wanting to talk to a gent named of Wetterling. He hires for them.
Is that a fact?
It sure is. And a mighty particular fella he is, too. Especially when it comes to hiring for Miss Nana.
I think I'll see the owner.
You do as you like, mister.
Thanks for the tequila. And the advice. Outside on the boardwalk, I stood for a while in the shade of the awning and rolled a cigarette. I'd seen 100 towns like Battle Basin. I had even lived in a few. The same dusty main street lined with shops, the same houses. Even the occasional cowhand looked familiar. A woman was coming up the street, walking fast. She had flame-red hair and brown eyes, and her skin was golden and smooth. When she saw my horse, she stopped dead still.
Where did that horse come from?
Man rode in about an hour ago. He's in the saloon.
What did he look like, Billy?
She was staring at the horse as the boy spoke, and I could see from the look on her face that she remembered our ride back from Las Cruces together. She was all woman, that one. And she had it where it showed. She wore her sex like a badge, flaunting it like a challenge. The way I liked it. I stepped out into the sunlight, the cigarette held firmly in my lips. Hello, Nana.
Hello, Lou.
This is a long way from Mazatlan. You were lovely then, too.
Lou, I thought you were...
I never heard from you, Nana.
I thought you were on the island. A prisoner. I thought you were still there.
I kept remembering you. No walls could hold me.
Lou.
So I found a way out and away. Get along without me.
Ha! Oh, hold it!
Oh!
As we looked at one another...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.